first.
Okay. Thank you, Clara. ¿Me escucháis bien? Can you hear me well?
Yeah.
Okay. So, as Clara said, I will summarize the status of the ProtoDUNE program at CERN. I will start introducing the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment, the physics goals, and in which the technologies we are using. Then I will summarize and present the ProtoDUNE program at CERN Neutrino Platform with the two prototypes that has been installed and operated at CERN, ProtoDUNE single phase and ProtoDUNE dual phase. Then I will focus in the ProtoDUNE dual phase scintillation light analysis results, because it's the most of the work that I have done for my thesis. And then I will finish with the explaining the ProtoDUNE phase two and the prospects of the future of the experiments. And I will finish with the conclusions. So the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment and the U of DUNE stands for underground. You can see here a picture of the excavation works that are ongoing now to install the one of the detectors 1.5 kilometers underground. So this is a reality that is happening now. We are working underground now. So Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment is a long baseline neutrino oscillation experiment. It will detect a beam of neutrinos produced in Fermilab, and it will be detected 1,500 kilometers away. So it's very long baseline. DUNE has now more than 1,300 collaborators from 33 countries. So many physicists are working in this project. It is an important project included in the European strategy of particle physics to have an effort in the DUNE experiment. And DUNE specifically will consist in the most powerful beam, as I said, installed in Fermilab, that will work in muon neutrino and anti-muon neutrino mode. So it will work in two modes. And a near detector to monitor the beam, placed near the beam, and then a far detector placed in the Sanford Underground Research Facility that will consist in four modules with a total mass of 70 kilotons of liquid argon, and it will be placed 1.5 kilometers underground. So you can see just with the numbers the scale of the project we are talking about. So it's a very big project. So I will start presenting the scientific goals. So why we are doing this? What do you want to do? What are our goals? So our primary goal is neutrino oscillation, for sure. So here you can see the appearance probability of for the neutrino oscillation in muon and in muon neutrino and anti-neutrino mode for our baseline. So our baseline is 1,300 kilometers. And the idea is that with the broad energy beam that we will have, that it will cover this energy range from 0.5 giga electron volts to 5 giga electron volts. This is most of the amount of the neutrinos we will have. We will cover this first to maximum, that you can see that we have a very big difference behavior for different delta CP values. So we will measure very well the oscillation of the neutrinos, and we with a very good precision, and we will be able to determine both CP violation and the neutrino mass ordering. So just to remember you, the observation of the CP violation in the neutrinos will be a big milestone in order to understand the origin of the baryon asymmetry and to explain the leptogenesis of the universe. And the neutrino mass ordering also is crucial to understand to have a deep understanding of the flavor physics. So here you have the study that has been done by the collaboration of the sensitivity plots. And we expect with the performance that is the baseline performance of the detector in 5 years, 50% of the delta CP values will be included by three sigmas. So in 5 years, we will be able to measure to already know where is the value of delta CP, and the mass ordering will be determined just in 2 years. The neutrino mass ordering will be determined with 5 sigmas regarding delta CP. So this is the performance that we will have. And yes, yes. Then we have other scientific goals. So I am focusing the primary goal, so the main contribution that we want to have. So one of those is proton decay searches. We can due to the big to the large mass that we will have in the far detector that we are placed underground, so we have almost no backgrounds. So we can perform proton decay searches. The proton decay is very relevant, is observed because it could lead to grand unification theories. So this would be a huge discovery if we discover that, but at least we can establish the some limits to the proton lifetime. So we have done sensitivity studies in many proton decay channels. For example, in this proton decay channel, proton go into a kton plus a neutrino. The DUNE will have a very competitive measurement of 10 to the 34 years for 10 years of exposure and 90% confidence level. Now, the measurement of this lifetime is in 10 to the 32. So it would be 2 orders of magnitude better. So just to tip a little bit why we would have such a good sensitivity is because the good resolution of our detector. So it's a big detector, but we also have very good resolution. Here you can see an event, a simulated event of a proton decay event. So the proton would decay here into a kton and the muon, and then the proton decay into a kton, then the kton to a muon, and then to an electron. So we could have background signals that are mainly due to atmospheric neutrinos that have a very similar topology. You can see here a background signal that actually, if you just look at the event, they look the same. So the thing is, DUNE will have such a good sensitivity that we will be able to do particle ID in the signals, and we can distinguish that this is a kton and this is a proton. And so thanks to these particle ID capabilities, using the DD over DX and the Bragg P, the deposition of the energy and so on, we can separate very well these two signals and have a very good measurement of the proton lifetime. So another scientific goal is to measure the neutrinos from a core collapse supernova within our galaxy. The key point of this is that these supernova neutrinos are actually small energy neutrinos. From the neutrinos from the beam are in the GeV scale. Here we are talking about very small energy neutrinos. Here you can see an example of a track from a neutrino coming from a supernova, a simulation for sure. And you can see that the track is just 4 centimeters. But the thing is, the resolution we will have, we will be able to detect these kind of events. So potentially, we will be able to detect for sure the number of events we expect to have. A big amount of neutrinos coming from a core collapsing supernova if this happens, but for sure this depends on the distance. So if this happens in the galaxy age, we spend around 1,000 of energy neutrinos. So you can imagine the amount of physics we can do if we detect 1,000 of neutrinos. We can obtain the energy spectrum, the time profile, and we can study. This can provide us information about the stellar evolution and so on. Also, the competitive point of DUNE is that we will have a good measurement of the electronic component of the neutrino flux, and it will act also as an early trigger with pointing capabilities. The thing is, the neutrinos come directly to the detector because they almost not interact, less than light. So we have an early signal of neutrinos that we can detect, and due to these short tracks, we can actually point the direction of the incoming neutrinos and just warn to the telescopes in the other part of the world just to point to this point of the sky to see the core collapsing supernova. So this is a very beautiful application of the detector. Finally, but not least, there is other scientific goals. They are not the primary goals, but there is many other contributions because we have a very powerful beam. We have a huge mass placed underground with almost no background, so we can do contribution in many other fields. I have summarized here a little bit of the contribution that we expect to do, like other beyond standard model physics, non-standard interaction, search of sterile neutrinos, heavy lepton, heavy neutral lepton searches, low mass dark matter and boosted dark matter searches, and even more neutrino physics with using atmospheric neutrinos, which is not the baseline of our goals, but we will also detect atmospheric neutrinos for sure. We will measure neutrino cross-section and nuclear effects, and even there is some people studying talking about detecting and studying solar neutrinos, even the low energy of the solar neutrinos. So how do we reach these goals? What is the detector design? Why we will have this good performance? First, we have the beam. The beam will be very powerful. It will be the most powerful. So it will start with only 1.2 megawatts, but it will be upgraded to 2.4 megawatts. It will run in muon neutrino and anti-muon neutrino mode, and it will have the peak of the energy at 2.5 giga electron volts with a broad energy spectrum from 0.5 to 5 giga electron volts. We will have a total amount of protons at a target of 10 to the 21. So for comparison, in T2K, the protons of target they have, it was 10 to the 21, but they needed 5 years to collect such statistics. So in only 1 year, we will have these statistics. And the energy of the protons will be from 60 to 120 giga electron volts. So the protons enter in the target, then they go into our mesons that decay into our muons and neutrinos. The muons are shielded, and then we have the neutrino beam. So then we have the near detector. The near detector is very important because we need to monitor the neutrino beam in order to compare with the far detector and measure the oscillation, the appearance and disappearance of the neutrino components. So first we have it is placed at 600 meters from the neutrino source, and it will consist in three subdetectors. We will have three different technologies in order to characterize very well the beam. We have first a liquid argon TPC that will be the same technology, very similar technology to the far detector. Then we have a gaseous argon TPC with a magnetic field surrounded by the calorimeter. And this will give us, since we have the magnetic field, the momentum of the sign of the muons. And we will have finally also, these two are movable. As you can see here, these two subdetectors will move across the profile of the beam. The beam will be in this direction, and this will move in this axis, so we can actually see the profile of the beam. And then we have SAM, which is the magnetized beam monitor that actually used a different target. And this is important to remove some systematic, because the target is different, it's not argon, so we can actually obtain more information. So, and finally, we have the far detector. The far detector, as I said, will be placed underground, 1.5 kilometers underground. It will be composed by four modules like this. This is a drawing of the cavern that is being excavated now in Sanford mine. And we will have four of those in these four caverns. And all this cavern is just for instrumentation from cryogenics and so on. So you can imagine the huge challenge of having these four detectors built 1.5 kilometers underground, and all the cryogenics, the installation and everything working at such a depth. So these four detectors will be liquid argon TPCs, but since the installation of the modules will be done step by step and we will need some time, different technologies are being considered, and we are also taking advantage of the improvements of the technology in order to implement it in the successive module. So this is a long path that started years ago with smaller prototypes, and we are building now a larger prototype. So what are the challenges of building such a large liquid argon DPC? We want to go to the kiloton scale to a liquid argon DPC in the order of 12 meters per 12 meters per 60 meters, so very large. What are the challenges of such a large liquid argon DPC? So in a liquid argon DPC, when a muon, a particle, crosses liquid argon, it produces ionization electrons that are drifted and read out in the anode. So if we have a big liquid argon DPC, having such a, you need longer drifts, so the electrons can be captured by impurities. So first you need very high purity, but then you can have two approaches of facing this challenge. The single phase approach is to keep short the drift. So you have an horizontal drift and you select the drift you want to have. So you divide the volume and you keep the drift shorter. So this is like a safest approach that has been tested in Icarus and many other liquid argon TPCs with this horizontal drift. Then you have the dual phase approach that say, no, let's have just a full volume, a monolithic volume, but we will read out the electrons vertically. So we drift the electrons vertically. Remember that for the far detector will be 12 meters. And so we should drift the electrons 12 meters, but then just to compensate the attenuation and the possible capture by impurities, then you add an argon gas layer in the top where you extract the electrons and amplify it with an electron multiplier in order to amplify the signal. So you can compensate the possible attenuation. So in theory, this would be the performance of this would be much better. You would have a better signal to noise, but you can imagine the huge challenge of having a huge far detector with the liquid argon interface stable in order to extract the electron. So it's a very challenging project and very risky. So this was tested successfully by the 3x1 prototype at the scale of 3x1 by 1 meters. But for sure, before going to DUNE, this would need to be validated because it's a very risky technology, but it has many advantages because you only have to instrument to make the instrumentation from the top, and you can do the instrumentation of all the volume just in one side of the volume. Not you don't need to do it several times. So then, second, you have also the light signal. Apart from the ionization electron, you have BUV light production at 127 nanometers that are produced and detected by the photon detection system. So the photons, they are produced in all directions. So it's not like the electrons that you drift and you can read out all the signal. The photons just propagate in all directions and you can lose it because they are also easily absorbed by the elements inside the liquid argon. So for that, you need large area detectors. In that case, you have also different approaches. The safe approach in this case was the dual phase approach. It was to use a large area for the multipliers coated with a wavelength shifter in order to detect it. This was already tested by 3x1 and also by Icarus. And we know it was performing well, but you still have challenges because the photomultipliers has to be outside the liquid argon volume and you have a big volume to detect. So if you have like 12 meters to detect light from just from the button, it's a very challenge. And then you have the other approach that it was the single phase approach that is it was more risky because they proposed to build light guys and arapucas, that is a device that just trap the photons and guide them to silicon PMs. And the thing is they build this within the anode. So you have to work between the high voltage. And this was more challenging to make this work. But for sure you have a detector inside the volume that with the PMTs you cannot do it, but you have to work next to the very high voltage. So this brings us to the ProtoDUNE program at CERN Neutrino Platform. So as I said, as I introduced before, we build it two prototypes, ProtoDUNE single phase and ProtoDUNE dual phase at CERN Neutrino Platform. Here you see a picture of the EHNA1. It's a building in Prevesan at CERN. And this is where the prototypes were constructed, and they were exposed to the beam that came in this direction. So what was the goal? I remember you, the goal of this prototype was to validate these two technologies in order to be implemented in the DUNE far detector. ProtoDUNE single phase was constructed in 2017-2018, and ProtoDUNE dual phase a bit later in 2018-2019. Both has a very similar mass, being a bit larger ProtoDUNE single phase with 770 tons of liquid argon for 7050 for the dual phase. A ProtoDUNE single phase was exposed to the beam, a beam of pions, kaons, electrons, muons, and protons with a momentum in the range of 0.3 to 7 giga electron volts for a couple of months. And then it was exposed during around 1 year to cosmics. ProtoDUNE dual phase only took data with cosmics. And then both prototypes also perform xenon doping test. First, a ProtoDUNE single phase perform some xenon doping test, and then we receive in ProtoDUNE dual phase the xenon doping argon from the single phase in order to do our test in ProtoDUNE dual phase. So what are the details, the numbers of the two prototypes? For ProtoDUNE single phase, as I said, the single phase approach is to have an horizontal drift. So there they split it, the volume, into two drift volumes. The active volume was around 6 meters per 7.2 meters. And they split the volume. They have a cathode in the middle and two anodes to read out the charge in the two borders. So they need to do the instrumentation of these two sides. And the cathode is at 180 kilovolts. On the other side, the dual phase approach was to have the vertical drift. As I said before, in this case, we have almost the double drift. And so 6 meters, and we have the cathode at the bottom in order to have the nominal drift field of 0.5 kilovolts, the same in both prototypes. We have double the voltage at the cathode. So this was also very challenging to have a cathode operating at such a voltage and having a uniform drift field. And then the charge, the electrons are extracted to the gas phase and amplified, and here you can see a drawing of how it works. The electrons are accelerated with an extraction grid to the interface vapor to liquid, and then they already in the vapor they are amplified in an electron multiplier. So you can imagine such a challenge of having a surface of 6 per 6 meters in the liquid surface stable within just 1 centimeter, because from the LEM to the extraction grid is only 1 centimeter distance. So this was very challenging. So in theory, you have here with the amplification and the thinner pitch of the readout, because here you have 5 millimeter pitch in the anodes, and here we have a 3 millimeter pitch, we have a better signal to noise. So concerning the light detections and the challenges that that brings, the two approaches were also different. For ProtoDUNE single phase, as I said, the photon detectors are integrated in the anodes, in the APAS, and they are behind the cable mesh that is used to read out the charge. They capture the photons and guide them to silicon pins that are placed at the borders, and here you can see a picture of it. They tested three different technologies, Arapukas and two model of light guides. For ProtoDUNE dual phase, we used 36 large area Hamamatsu PMTs of 8 inches diameter, and using two different wavelength shifters, 6 coated with TPB and 30 with foil on top. So the challenge here, especially for the ProtoDUNE dual phase, was that we are detecting a very big volume with 6 meters distance, just with PMTs on the bottom. We have very long distance with a large attenuation. And yes, that's it. So this was the design. Did it work? How did they perform? How was the operation? So I start presenting the operation of ProtoDUNE single phase. and the results. So as I introduced before, the data taking was around 1 year and a half, from 2018 to 2020, first with BIM and then with COSMICS and Xenon test. They take data at here you can see a drawing of the BIM particles that they have, and they operate the detector during all this time at nominal condition with in a very stable way, and they a big goal is that a big achievement is that they reach a very high purity. They measure a lifetime of over 100 milliseconds. That means that an ionization electrode that is created in the liquid argon lives up to 100 milliseconds. So that's a lot. You can have long drifts without the electron being absorbed and without attenuation. Here you can see actually the vertical axis is the attenuation of the signal. So when the high purity is reached, you have almost no attenuation. Also, concerning the light detection, they discovered that the Arapucas were much more efficient, so they were selected as a baseline for the next phases. Then they did also, they had a very good calibration of the detector response. Here you can see an example for beam positrons at different energies. They have a very linear response. They perform a pion and proton argon cross-section measurements. And thanks to the good resolution that they have, you can see the d over dx for proton from beam protons and with different at different distance, and they can perform very good particle identification to distinguish one particle from other. So here you can see, for example, the separation between using d over dx of positrons versus photons. Some of the first results are summarized in this paper. If you have curiosity, you can go and deep in it. And here I can add a little zoo of particles just to show the event displays how they look. In first place, you have a muon that comes here, an stopping muon that comes here horizontally and decay into a Michel electron. Here you can see a zoom of this. You can appreciate the good resolution that we had. Here is a 1GeV a beam proton, an stopping proton that enter into the active volume and is stopped. And here you see a pion, a pi plus with a proton and two gammas. And this is an electronic shower is entered the volume and it goes into a shower, just entering. You can see the details that it actually the resolution is very good and the events are beautiful. So concerning ProtoDUNE dual phase, ProtoDUNE dual phase also took data with cosmic muons from September 2019 to October 2020. It used first liquid argon and then xenon double liquid argon, refilling the xenon double liquid argon from ProtoDUNE single phase. Here you can see the force, the concentration we have at the situation, because at the different situations, because we also perform nitrogen injection in order to study the effect of the nitrogen in the light. And this was the largest dual phase TPC ever constructed and operated. So it was a very big milestone. We obtained also a very good purity. And here you can see an example of a beautiful event with multiple hadronic interactions. But we have also some difficulties due to the big challenges that I explained before. First, it was very hard to have a stable liquid surface, because I remember you that it was a big surface and it has to be stable within 1 centimeter, and we have a problem with bubbles and so on. Here you can see a picture that the surface it was not stable, so we did some test with applying high pressure cycles and so on in order to have the surface stable, but we didn't reach to have a stable operation of the amplification system, even though we saw that actually, given the nice purity we had, without amplification we would see very nice track. This is an example of a track without amplification. Also, additionally, we had a problem in the high voltage system. So the electric field we have was not uniform. We should have 0.5 kilovolt per centimeter uniform in all the volume, but we have a short in the field cage. So the nominal field we have was not uniform and it was below 0.5. So we had a drift just in the top part of the volume. But I want to remember you that this was a very big challenge because we were operating at 300 kilovolts, but it was a big number. So concerning the photon detection system operation, as I said, it was kind of a safer option. It was stable during the full operation. We detected light, both scintillation and electroluminescence light. That is, the scintillation is producing the liquid, the electroluminescence in the gas. In all the PMTs, here you can see an example of a scintillation light, which we call an S1, and this is the scintillation plus the secondary S2 electroluminescence light that is generated by the extracted electrons in the gas. We perform weekly calibration using a dedicated calibration system that we designed by CIEMAT. Here you can see the stability of the gain during the full operation. And we had a very good signal to noise and a good response of the PMTs. Here you can see the linearity with the gain. I have added also some of the particles, some of the events that we took with ProtoDUNE dual phase. You can see here a muon decay candidate and some other electronic showers here. In this case, is shown the two views per event. So these two views correspond are channel versus time for the two different views that we have in the detector. So these two are actually the same event, these two also and these two also. I want to remark the CIEMAT contribution to ProtoDUNE dual phase. The neutrino group was involved in ProtoDUNE dual phase since the beginning. It was responsible for the photon detection system together with CIFAE. We performed a full characterization of all the 36 PMTs at CIEMAT. We designed and installed a dedicated calibration system. We did the installation, commissioning, and also we operate the system during all the data taking, and we are now performing the analysis of the light data. We didn't work only in the photon detection, but we also participated in other parts. We participated in the assembly of the cryostat. Here you can see some pictures and the cleaning of the cryostat and everything that was needed because we had always people around CERN to help. Here you can see the picture of some colleagues of the group working there. So now I move to ProtoDUNE dual phase scintillation light analysis result, which is the work that will go mainly to my thesis and also to Ana Gallego's thesis. So the goals of ProtoDUNE dual phase, I remind you of the photon detection system of ProtoDUNE dual phase, is detecting scintillation and electroluminescence light from 6 meters away. Well, I have shown you before already that all the PMTs were detecting light. And the scintillation light in liquid argon is produced by the radiative decay of excited argon dimers. When the muon excited an argon atom, it creates a molecule, a dimer of argon that goes into two energy states that decay with different lifetimes. So we have a fast signal and then a slow signal. And the thing is, these two processes depends on the purity. So if we monitor the shape of the light, we can measure the slow component and we can monitor the purity of the scintillation light. So we want to study also the dependence of the light signal with the drift field, because this process is also affected by the amount of electrons that we have around. And if we have a drift, we remove the electrons. Then we want to analyze the difference between the different wavelength shifters, PEN and TPV, and characterize the light attenuation with the distance, which is dominated by the Rayleigh scattering length, because we have a very pure liquid argon. So the main factor that attenuate the light signal is the Rayleigh scattering. Just to remember you, the Rayleigh scattering is an elastic scattering of a photon with the argon atoms around. And if we have a short Rayleigh scattering, that means that the photons are interacting more frequently and the photons are more confined around the deposition point. While if we have a long Rayleigh scattering length, they just travel straight forward and they go directly to the BMT or to be absorbed in the world. And then we want also to study the impact of the xenon doping in the light detection because it acts as a wavelength shifter. The xenon enters here and shifts the production of the light to a different wavelength with a different Rayleigh scattering length. So we have a longer Rayleigh scattering length of 9 meters. So if we have xenon, we have the light just traveling straight forward. So I start with the liquid argon scintillation, the study of the time profile. So as I said, studying the average profile, you can see here, this average profile is just the sum, the addition of several waveforms. If you invert the signal and put it in log axis, you can see that we have two main components, a fast component and a slow component. The slow component is related with the purity. And if you plot this slope versus time, you can see that when the operation started, the tau slow increases as the purification increases, and then we reach a plateau because we lose the sensitivity to the purity at this level. So the purity was above our sensitivity with the tau slow. We also studied the dependence of the tau slow with the cathode voltage, that this result was shown before by Inchiara's thesis. And the interesting of this result is that it's in opposition with with the expected values in the literature that was published years ago. So, but we are consistent with Chiara, which is important. And our result also show a difference in the tau slow. I didn't mention that apart from the fast of the slow, if you see here, there is not this is not a pure two exponential. We need to add in order the fit to converge to our third exponential here in the middle, that is the intermediate component. So this intermediate component is different for PEN and TPV. This was not clear before because it was a discussion in the community, the origin of this tau intermediate. And by measuring this, that is different for PEN and TPV, we can affirm that this is a consequence of having different wavelength shifters. So it's like a delayed emission of the TPV when the fast signal arrived. Then we have the PEN and TPV wavelength shifting efficiency studies. We have two wavelength shifters. We have TPV coated on PMTs and PEN foils placed on top. Here you can see a picture of the two different wavelength shifters. They are fluorescent materials that convert the incident UV photons into visible photons in the range of 400 nanometers. Here you can see both spectrums, that they are very similar actually for both materials. But the emission spectrum is very similar, but the efficiency is very different. So the aim of this study is to characterize the relative efficiency of both systems. So to do this, we compare average signals, the signal average of two PMTs, one with PEN and another with TPV, just played symmetrically with respect to a trigger PMT that is selecting muon tracks crossing nearby. So since we don't know the track topology because we are using only the light information, we don't have the track from the chart. We cannot compare in an event by event basis, but we can compare the full distribution. So if we just divide the mean of the two distribution, you can see that actually just multiplying by a factor, the two distribution are actually quite coincident. So by doing this in several PMT pairs placed symmetrically, so we can compare on average, we obtain that TPV PMTs detect 4 times more photons than PEN PMT. So we have a factor 4 between PEN and TPV, between TPV and PEN. 0.25 if we do the inverse. But then we have difference in the geometry here. The TPB is directly coated and the pen is a foil, actually just placed tangent to the photocathode, but a bit separated, so it's not directly comparable. So in order to correct this, I performed some simulations in order to estimate the correction of this, of what would be the efficiency if both have the same geometry. So you can see here a drawing that actually the pen foil actually is a foil that is separated, so it has the two faces of the foil exposed to the liquid argon, and while the TPB it has only one. And when the re-emission of the blue light is done, the foil is separated from the photocathode, so you lose more light than from the TPB coating. So if you correct this effect, we have a factor. We find that actually the pen is a bit more efficient, but it's still below the TPB. We have a factor 3. So actually the TPB re-emits 3 times more photons than pen for the same amount of incident light. So I have developed also a detailed Monte Carlo simulation of the detector. For this, I implemented a detailed detector geometry in GDML. And we also did data-driven event simulation for CRT muons. So we have 2 CRTs placed on the 2 cryostat walls to detect diagonally crossing muons. So this is simulated in the Monte Carlo by taking the information of the muons we are selecting, and we plug this into the Monte Carlo in order to simulate the proper geometry. And then we also simulate the background of cosmics that we have using Corsica, which is a generator that provides us the pre-generated Corsica showers with different origins from protons, iron, and neon showers. Here you see a drawing of a proton shower. And then we have also once the energy is deposited in the TPC and this energy is converted into photons, these photons propagate to the PMTs, and this propagation is very heavy. It is very demanding in CPU resources. So to avoid simulate the track of every photon every time, we pre-generate what we call photon library. So we just simulate the track of this photon once, and then we store it in a library. And then if we have energy deposited at some point, we just know that we have a certain probability to detect a photon in certain PMT. Oh, this is the information that is drawn here, actually. So if one MeV is deposited over here, we will detect on average around 1 photoelectron. So I also simulated a detailed response of the PMT, including the gain, the counts, and the noise. So now I move to the study on the scintillation light produced by CRT trigger muons that are shown here. So using the 3D trajectory provided by the CRT panels, we can actually compute the distance from the PMTs to the track. And you can see that we detect light from muon tracks crossing 6 meters away, which was one of the goals of the photon detection system. So the light reduction that we see, if we compare with the cathode on, so we have drift field, we expect a reduction of the light that you can see here, and is in these 2 points, that this is actually, this value comes from this field. And this reduction is compatible with previous measurement from other experiments like the 3x1, for example. We also studied the photon propagation of the CRT trigger muons. So we did a study in order to test 2 possible Rayleigh scattering length, because this is a parameter that it was not well established in the literature. There were some measurements, and 2 different papers pointed to these two different values. So we generated 2 Monte Carlo samples to compare with the data. And you see here that actually the Rayleigh scattering length of 100 meters, of 1 meter, obtain an attenuation that is compatible with the data. This attenuation is obtained from doing an exponential fit here. You see here that actually we have a little shift on the comparing data with Monte Carlo, an absolute fit, but if we do the ratio, the slope, which is what gives us the attenuation, is what is interesting for us to obtain the Rayleigh scattering, is more compatible for 1 meter of Rayleigh scattering length. So we have also simulated, well, the simulation also includes the reflection, which is an important contribution of around 11% of the photons detected by EPMTs. So we have also measured the cosmic neutron flux that is detected by the photon detection system. This is done by counting S1 signals, scintillation light signals, like is done in this algorithm, in this window. This is an example event of 1 millisecond, and every S1 signal that is crossing this threshold would be like a crossing neutron that is providing an S1 signal. So we measure a rate that is stable with time, and we have compared the average charge of the S1 detected and the average rate with Monte Carlo, and we are obtaining promising results. Here you can see that they are quite close one to each other, but we are still tuning this to understand well our detector. So here you can see a drawing of the rate that we obtain in the light and the Monte Carlo. The points in red means that we have a larger rate on these PMTs. It's square here is a PMT, as they are placing the detector, is because they have TPV on top, so they are more efficient at detecting light, so they have a larger rate. This is for sure expected. I move to the last point, that is the study of the xenon dope liquid argon. So as I said before, our cryostat was refilled with xenon dope liquid argon contaminated with nitrogen, and then we performed 2 nitrogen injections. And the question we have is, now that we have xenon and nitrogen inside our detector, how this perform in our detector? How this affect us? Xenon, and as I said before, acts as a wavelength shifter. It shifts the scintillation light to a longer wavelength of 178 nanometers, and this but this happens only in the slow component. So we will have a fast component still about 127 nanometers, and then a slow component at 178 nanometers. That is this bump that appears when we do the average waveform. So we have a fast signal at 127, at a slow signal at 178 nanometers. So this second component, this slow component, have a longer Rayleigh scattering length of 9 meters versus 1 meter for 127 nanometers. So we expect a better detection efficiency at large distances because the light travels straightforward. And but also we have to take into account that xenon absorbs light at 127 nanometers, so we expect this amplitude to be decreased. And we have also the effect of the nitrogen that quenched the light production, and also it absorbed it during propagation. So what are the data results? To do this, we compare between two different kinds of data. We have PMT trigger muons and CRT trigger muons. PMT trigger muons are crossing on average at 2 meters from the PMT, and CRT trigger muons at 4 meters from the PMTs. Here, I have plotted the amplitude and the charge of the signal in the four-doping situation that we have. So the reduction of the amplitude that we see here is equivalent to the reduction of the fast signal that we expected. So we have a 35 reduction due to the xenon absorption, and then it's not affected by the nitrogen injections. For the charge, we observe that the light detection is increased largely as we expected, and is increased much more for the CRT trigger muons that are placed farther than for the PMT trigger muons. So as it was expected. So we have also a better detection uniformity, since we have the gain is larger for farther events. So, and this is of high interest for DUNE, and it's being studied for the next module because we will have a very big volume. So if we have a better detection uniformity and more light from events happening farther, this is good news. So I will finish talking about the phase two and the future of the DUNE program. I'm sorry because I'm taking too long. And the prospects of the future of ProtoDUNE single phase is to have a second run, ProtoDUNE single phase 2. that will be is called module zero because it will be the final design for the DUNE far detector. So the main design is that they will have Arapukas for the photon detection system without the other modules, and they won't use xenon doping, and they have minor charge changes in the anode and cathode. The components are being produced now, and they expect to be start early next year to start taking data at the second part and in autumn of next year, with having DIM data again in October 2022. So then, if everything goes well, the plan will go to begin the installation of the far detector using the ProtoDUNE single phase technology, scaling the size of the detector by 20 times in total mass. Here you can see a drawing of how it will look the detector in the far detector. So I want to remark the contribution also of two ProtoDUNE's single phase phase two and the DUNE far detector by the group of CIEMAT. The group has been working in the photon detection system of the ProtoDUNE single phase phase two by working in the design and validation of the Arapukas and the silicon PMs using the Arapukas. Here you can see a setup that is in the IR02, so here in our building, and is a quite a complex setup with a very big vessel, instrumentation, the data acquisition system that liquefies gas argon inside in order to measure the performance of the Arapuka. Here you can see the drawing of the of an Arapuka measure inside the performance in liquid argon. So CIEMAT is testing silicon PMs, the cold electronics also, and the air X Arapukas for the module zero, that is the ProtoDUNE single phase phase two, and also for the first module of the far detector. So they selected the silicon PM that is assembled inside the Arapuka, and we will do also the measurement of the X Arapuka detection efficiency in liquid argon using liquefied gas argon, and they will also validate all the Arapukas to be installed in a large vessel in liquid nitrogen. Here I have added a detail of the previous setup of the 300 vessel with three separated volumes inside with that are designed for the Arapuka test to liquefying gas argon inside to have liquid argon and test the Arapuka. Here you can see also a picture of the calibration box that we are using, using an americio and 241 americio alpha source in order to detect scintillation light for the calibration. Here you can see an example of the signal that we see that is clearly scintillation light, so the system is working well. What about ProtoDUNE dual phase? So the prospect for ProtoDUNE dual phase is that in order to overcome the problems arising in the previous design, it will evolve into a vertical drift. So it will be the dual phased TPC, but operating in single phase mode. So it won't have, it will keep the vertical drift, but it will remove the gas phase. We will have still the 6 meters drift and profit in the high purity we have. We don't need, we think that we don't need actually the amplification. So removing the gas, we just will read out the signals in the anode and the top. So they include a xenon doping as a baseline in order to detect light better in the full volume. And they, since the design is different, they cannot put PMTs because in the far detector, the volume will be split into volumes in the top and in the bottom. PMTs cannot be in the bottom now because you have this second anode just covering everything. They will assemble Arapukas just in the anode like they did in the single phase. So just to remark that the cathode will be still at 300 kilovolts, so this is challenging. The full-scale prototype will be installed at CERN again in this year, to 2023, around 2023 to 2024. And the goal is to do a second module for the DUNE far detector as this vertical drift design, splitting the drift into two volumes of 6.5 meters of drift, upwards and downwards, and having the cathode at the middle still at 300 kilovolts. This is actually half than the previous dual phase far detectors. That would be 600, so it's half, but this is still challenging. And the installation would start, the design is validated in the prototype, in 2026. So then we have more modules. What do we plan to do with the other modules? We are exploring several possibilities. We call it module of opportunity because we see it as an opportunity to implement the improvements, enhancement, and from the what we are learning in the installation of the other, in the building of the other prototypes in order to improve the performance. So we are exploring possibilities like having longer drifts, having a magnetized liquid argon TPC in order to improve the particle identification capabilities, or also improve the readout of the charge by replacing the wires in the anode by strips, pixels, and so on. Then we have, there is also proposal to have a totally different detector, like the opaque liquid scintillator a la Liquido. So this, we had a seminar here some time ago that Carmen presented us this project of Liquido. So we are considering to have a detector using this technology, and also a water-based, even they are considering a water-based liquid scintillation as a for the detector. So this was everything. I'm sorry I take too long. The conclusion of my seminar is that DUNE will be a long baseline neutrino experiment that will resolve the latest questions that we still have in neutrino oscillations, but it will contribute also to many other fields, proton decay, supernova, and beyond that. The ProtoDUNE program at CERN Neutrino Platform is succeeding validating the liquid argon technologies. The conservative approach of the single phase operated successfully and will have a second run before going to the far detector. The bold approach of the dual phase that was very risky is evolving into a single phase vertical drift design to overcome the difficulties, but they are still working to solve all the problems they have and have a second module. And the operation of the ProtoDUNE dual phase photon detection system was very stable. And we have obtained many interesting results that will be published soon in a paper that we are preparing. We detected light from more than 6 meters away. That was a milestone. We validated our Monte Carlo simulation that was also used for the TDR of DUNE. And we have done pioneering studies in the xenon doping performance that is of interest of all the liquid argon TPC community. And finally, just to remind you that the first far detector will be installed in 2024. The installation will start this year, so this is very soon. And then the next module will profit from all the activities that are on the way and all the things that we are learning. So that's everything. If you have any question or comment.
Thanks, Jose, for the wonderful talk. There's a lot of things there. So as you said, if people have questions, you can raise your hand. Or just... I see one hand. Yeah, Juan.
Yeah, is I hope you hear me well. Can you hear? Okay. So thanks for this very informative talk, Jose. It's mainly a curiosity. Why is the surface in the dual phase? Why is the surface unstable?
Well, you can imagine that it's a very big volume. So the problem we have is where because of bubbles, because you have to maintain the interface between the liquid and gas. You have both liquid and gas, so you need to be you need to have both the states on the same time. So it was not trivial to have this surface without bubbles. So we saw that increasing the pressure, we could have a stable surface during some time, but at some point they started again to bubbling.
So it's because you have some kind of convection. I know nothing about these noble elements, but so you have bubbles because you have convection?
No, not convection. I don't think the convection is playing a role there. It's because you have the two states, gas and liquid, both at the same time, and you have also a big source of heat inside the liquid argon that are the cathode and the, all the elements that are live with a very high voltage. So actually, it was we discovered that it was very easy actually to just to have some source of bubbles and just to have an unstable situation. In ProtoDUNE single phase, they didn't have cameras actually. They didn't even know if they had bubbles or not. For sure, if they have bubbles, it didn't affect their performance. But for sure, that was actually, yes, a big deal because you need to have a very stable surface in all the anode readout plane. So that was it.
Okay, is it not going to affect the new design where you don't have a gas?
Exactly. Since we moved to a single phase, we don't care now about the surface of the liquid and gas because we could remove the gas. Yes, exactly.
Mm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Carmen?
No, it's the bubble stuff is just to that these bubbles suspect to be created by some source of some heat at some point, and then there are some destructor and some weak points where these bubbles could go up because of the field cage structure and so on, then keeping the temperature constants, avoiding these convection movements by increasing the pressure, they have seen that they can reduce these bubbles. I don't know if it is a bit more clear than Jose has explained, but just to add a bit more information.
Yeah, thank you, Carmen. Yeah, I mean, now I understood more better that it has to do with temperature and it.
Yeah.
Convection is involved.
Yeah, well, because there are some the structure of the field cage and so on favor some regions where this bubble can accumulate it and go up, let's say, because it's just a unpredictable behavior because of the bubbles and so on are expected to be quite small. But if they're because of the structure of the field cage, they can accumulate it at some points, doing bigger these bubbles and so on. Okay, just something is a bit very difficult to predict. And then has not been observed in the single phase because, as Jose has explained, they have not cameras there because they it's not important for the single phase at all.
Okay. Thanks.
Are there more questions? I would ask you that know a lot now about wavelength shifting, how would you design your experiment, if you could? Would you add xenon, PEN, TPB?
You mean a far detector?
Yes, or far detector light.
Yeah, probably having xenon doped, it would be a good idea, yes. And this would need to be studied, yes, because you have a better detection efficiency with the xenon, and then if you could use PEN, you mean, instead of TPB? I doubt that, actually. You would need to do the simulation in order to validate that, as we did for the TDR. But I don't think that just adding xenon, you can just get rid of the TPB and use PEN. Mm.
Well, also TPB has been stable, so.
And also TPB was stable during the full operation. That was one of the main questions when they install it. So yeah.
Thanks. Last chance to ask a question to Jose. Nacho.
Yes, I was wondering, so you said at the end that there's a possibility of having far detectors of two types then?
Yes, the idea of the far detectors is that we will have a first module based on single phase. Then the second will be this vertical drift. This is the baseline now, if the prototype that they are building now is validated. If not, we plan to have the backup possibility to produce a second single phase far detector module, because okay. it's a reality that this wouldn't work. Mm-hmm. And then we will go building it just one by one, implementing improvements as we obtain it and we validate the technology.
So then what I wanted to understand is, what is the advantage or disadvantage of having a mixture of two types of far detectors?
Well, the advantage of having, for example, this vertical drift design is that we expect to have the same performance or even better, and it will be much cheaper, because you can see that the instrumentation that we need is much smaller than the single phase. That is, it would be full of surfaces, as you see here, instrumented. So instead of having two instrumented, you have only. Instead of having all these volumes divided, you have.
Okay, and given that the schedule you have, DUNE has already to build already a first module with validated.
Exactly. Okay. The first design is the safest option, let's say, but it's also the most expensive. So we mm-hmm. want to improve the performance to make it cheaper, and this will be done in the next modules.
Mm-hmm. And from the analysis point of view, there would be simulations and everything. In principle, there's no.
What do you mean?
Yes, just that. Just that by the fact that you have two different detectors, I don't know if they are side by side or not.
You have to think that at the end is always liquid argon. So you only change the readout and maybe the noise pattern you have to apply, but at the end the detector is the same, it's liquid argon, and that's it, the physics will be the same. Mm-hmm. Only if the module of opportunity moves to a very different technology, that will be a challenge for the analysis. But if we just change some part of the readout or we have longer drift, we don't expect to have to be a big problem for the analysis, because it's always the same liquid argon.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
If I may complete this comment, this is a very interesting question, Nacho. I think we are also considering on lowering energy reach for the extra modules and expanding the physics towards lower neutrino energies that would allow us to go to dark matter searches and even neutrinoless double beta decay. So there are kind of proposals to design the detector, the far detector, reaching lower energies and be able to go a bit far away from the baseline physics that we want to achieve.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. Are there no more questions? So I think we can thank you, Jose, for the nice seminar.
Thank you for inviting me.
And remind you that we will have another seminar next week. I am not saying it wrong.
Yes, you'll get the announcement shortly.
Okay, so see you next week.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye.